church has been so good in here, I know there are going to be angels in there. Amen.
Amen.
If you got one, help him, Dale. There he goes. Man, I'd give a dollar for that smile every Sunday morning. Somebody walk by the pulpit and smile like that, or just tired. Makes me feel good. Thank you, worship team.
Amen.
Praise the Lord. We are excited about what God is doing around our around and in and through our church. Amen?
Amen.
God is doing something, and I like that. I don't always know what He's doing, but that's okay. I don't always have to know. He didn't call me to clear it with me. He just does it, and that's a good thing. Amen. We were excited last evening to unite Ron and Cindy in holy matrimony. That's their seats right there. And they're gone, and we did everything we could to find out where in Tahoe they were staying, but he would not reveal that information. And I know a true prophet would have known. God knew what my intentions were, so he didn't even reveal it to me. So, I want to give you some exciting news. On the last Sunday of the month, we're having a one-day revival. You know, that's the way things have gone. I was talking to Pastor Steve Pruitt, was here yesterday, a dear friend of ours, and he was relaying to us about Pastor Crabtree. How many know Charles Crabtree? Pastor in San Jose for years. He was in the district office for years. I mean, our general office, and he retired at the, and he is now at the ripe young age of 80. And he's still out just going, going, going. And he said, you know, I'm not, he told Steve, he said, I'm not as young as I used to be. Don't go quite as much as I used to. He said, my administrator scheduled me for a four-day meeting. And about 3 weeks before it happened, he said, I can't do 4 days. So he called them and canceled on them. And, you know, that's the truth. Some days it's hard to do 4 days. We used to do four-week revivals, 6 weeks long. Amen. But people used to come out for those six-week revivals or four-week revivals. We have enough difficulty getting to church on Sundays. Well, I'm not preaching at you yet. So we're going to have a one-day revival with the Crandall brothers on Sunday morning and Sunday night, the last Sunday of this month. And that you're going to be blessed. Yeah. How many has never heard the Crandall brothers before? Oh. Never heard. Hold your hand up. Wow. You weren't here, Chuck, when they were here?
Oh, yes.
I'm just curious if it was my memory or yours. If you have never heard them, you will be blessed.
Yes.
Brother Lee and, well, actually, Brother Lee is the only Crandall brother left. In fact, pray for them. Their dad, Melvin, died just last week. And he graduated to heaven, pastor for many years. So I know it's difficult on the family. Pray for them. But the Crandalls will be here the last Sunday of the month. Now, another happy note. On the 17th of August, is that right? I should have made that list today. So that's on a Wednesday night. Have you ever heard of Lily Knowles? Amen. How many has never heard of her? Check out some of the Gaither tapes. You'll see her singing. She used to sing with a group called, was it the Hawkins? Edward Hawkins. You know, have you ever heard of that one?
Yeah.
Oh, happy day when Jesus was You want me to sing some more?
Quit
preaching. In any case, she will be here for a one night, I won't say performance, but she'll be with us for one night. And she's been on many, many TV shows, and God has blessed her ministry to be able. There is posters in the back, too, that you can take home and put in your neighborhood grocery store and promote that event. And I would say come, we start at 6:30. I would suggest that you get here just a little bit early, or there might be an occasion to stand. But anyways, we got some exciting things going on, so keep it in mind, and we're excited about it. Amen. And now I only have 20 minutes to preach.
You got all day.
How many are thankful? No. No, that never stopped me before. Hallelujah. I'm concerned this morning because did I put the wrong paperwork in here? I've changed folders all week. Wait, that's not right, I know. There it is. We are preaching a series entitled Hurry Up and Wait. Amen. How many's ever been challenged to wait in your life? Now I'm talking about W-A-I-T, not W-E-I-G-H-T. I'm challenged with that all the time. So I'm weight challenged in a couple of areas, but I'm also weight W-A-I-T challenged. And I think we are all challenged to wait. And we started this series some time back, and I should publish this. Looking for my verse. Isaiah 40 and 31 is when we're where we're at. We're talking about patience. Hebrews 10:35, we shared with you, cast not away therefore your confidence, which hath great recompense of reward, for you have need of patience. Can I say that again? You have need of patience. Everybody's got somebody in your life that tries your patience. Everybody's got more than just one somebody that tries your patience. Well, there's many benefits to patience. We've been in the Book of Isaiah for a couple of weeks, 40 and 31. In fact, let me go and tell you, Psalms 27 to 14 says to wait on the Lord, be of good courage, and he shall strengthen your heart. He said, wait on the Lord and be of good courage, because he will strengthen your heart. Isaiah 40 and 31, but they that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings as eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. And we're in part of that scripture this morning, waiting on the Lord. Last week I started preaching on the section that they shall mount up with wings as eagles. I finished the message that day. And I thank you all for your response. No one ordered the tape. But as soon as I finished, a beautiful lady that just started attending our church, by the name of Ruth Marie, walked up to me and she said, I've got something for you. She wrote a book entitled, Who Are You? And the subtitle is, I Am a House of Prayer. Awesome little book. I don't know if you have many of those or if this was the last one. If you do, you can see Sister Ruth, and I don't know what they cost, but you can purchase one from her. You will be money well spent. And I'm not making anything on that advertisement. But there's a section that she checked in here for me to read. And it's a chapter entitled, hang on.
Gotta lick my finger.
Eagle, Saint, and Prayer. And it was all about the eagle. And I wished I had had that book the week before. Because I would have just got up here and preached from the book. Then this morning, Brother Charles came up. They had to leave early. He came up and gave me a book. The title is Soar as the Eagle. And he marked a spot, and I haven't had an opportunity to read it. But I want to thank you, for those of you who are listening to the sermons, and bringing me things about the sermon. Next week, I will be preaching on prime rib and its importance. I was going to preach on Adam's rib, but we changed it. We shall mount up with wings as eagles. I believe that we ought to, and we are sharing with you just exactly what that means. I told you I found a particular informational site. I appreciate Google. Not everything you read on Google is true. And Google don't know everything. But there's some useful information out there. One site I found had over 50 or 75 things about an eagle. I could have preached 75 points to this message. But I thought to myself, what's the point? But I did find some information out about eagles that I believe is relevant to you and I. And I shared with you last week some of the peculiarities of eagles. I told you that eagles fly alone at high altitudes. They don't fly with ravens and sparrows. They fly alone. Sometimes we need to separate ourselves from the things, from, can I say it, from the low-life things that we are involved with.
Amen.
The Bible said to come you out and be a separate. Why did he say that? Because he wants you to be rude?
No.
Because he wants you to look like a separatist? No, because he knows that things of this world will attach itself to you and weigh you down.
Right.
You see, we need to lay aside every weight and the sin that does so easily beset us. So that we might what? Run with patience the race that is set before us. We have to understand sometimes there's things that we don't need in our life, and God wants us to be like the eagle and fly above those things.
Amen.
That's a choice for you to make.
Amen.
I also talked about that eagles have a strong vision, and we told you that an eagle could see a rabbit over 2 miles away. Isn't that awesome? Man, if you're hunting cottontail, that's important. But he could see an eagle over 2 miles away. We told you that eagles don't eat dead things. You need to shuck off some of that dead stuff you've been chomping on. Right? Sometimes we walk into the kitchen, and I don't understand how they term things, but they talk about empty calories. How many know anything about that? How come empty calories are so satisfying? I mean, an empty bowl doesn't have anything to offer. An empty can can't get you very far. But empty calories are so inviting. I don't know what it is about a Twinkie. But it has some kind of spirit. It just draws you. And you can sit there and you can say, get thee behind me. And yet we fall into its prey. Don't eat empty calories, dead things. I concluded last week by talking about the fact that eagles love a storm. In fact, an eagle, when he sees a storm on the horizon, he begins to flutter. He gets all excited about it. It's like when I'm out fishing and you see a little school of fish come up to the surface in their bubble. What's it called, Kenny?
School.
A school?
A school.
And the more technical term is a school. But they swarm, and you know that's like a group of little shad that are swarming there, and it's they're swimming away because something real big is chasing them. And man, you throw your rod out, and you hope to hit whatever's chasing them. Get all excited about that. Well, the eagle sees a storm, and it's like a school of shad swimming through. They get all excited. Love a storm. They love a storm. Embrace your storm. God has something for you in that storm.
Amen.
I can't tell you what God will have for you, but you don't have to necessarily enjoy what you're going through. I shared in Sunday school this morning, but you embrace it. You embrace it. And in fact, I'll finish my statement. Until you embrace what you're going through, God can't move you through it. You can fuss with it, argue with it, unless you're into something out of God's will, and you know it, God will say, you know, not all storms are God's fault. Some of it you step in yourself.
Amen.
And God will tell you, get out of it. But we talked a great deal about that last week. I want to move on today and tell you something else that an eagle does. An eagle will test something before he trusts that thing. He will test it before he trusts. When a female eagle meets a male, they want a mate, she flies down to earth with a male pursuing her, and she picks up a twig. Once she's reached a certain height, a height high enough, she decides to let the twig fall to the ground, and she watches that twig as it falls. The male will chase after that twig. The faster it falls, the faster he chases it. He has to catch it before it hits the ground. He then brings it back to the female eagle. Isn't that awesome? The female eagle grabs the twig and flies to an even higher height. She will then drop the twig again for the male to chase the twig. This goes on for hours.
No wonder we're tired.
Until the female is positively assured that the male eagle has mastered the art of catching that twig, which shows commitment. Then and only then will she allow the male to mate. You see, we need to test things. We don't just jump after everything that moves. We don't just jump in head over heels. We don't just jump in without looking, without testing, without trying. Once you jump into something, my friend, a lot of times it's hard to get out of it. That pool that you thought was good, clear water it comes to me. Hang on, Mike. the sand that sucks you up?
Quicksand.
Thank you. It may look like a clear, cool pool, but you jump in, it could be quicksand that will swallow you alive. I got news for you. You need to test things before you just jump into it. Not everything that looks like gold and glitters like gold is actually gold. I got news for you. Again, when we go fishing, we buy those nice glittery lures, and they sparkle, so when you throw them in the water and the fish are swimming along and looking at it, all of a sudden he looks over and he sees something flash in the water. He thinks it's a piece of fish that he can eat, but when he hits it, he finds out it's only my glittery piece of rebel bait that I bought at the store, and I hook him. You see, that's what Satan will do sometimes.
Amen.
And all the glitters is gold. You have to test things. You can't use things that are tested. Remember when David was getting ready to face Goliath? There stood this giant out there. He had sword and spear and breastplate on. He was all dressed for battle. And as the children of Israel was hunkered down behind some stones, shivering and quaking in their boots, little David jumped up and said, "Who is this uncircumcised Philistine that challenges our God? Let's go out and kill this giant." And he went to Saul and said, "I'd like to take on this job." Saul said, "Okay, but I can't let you go out with just a slingshot. Here, put on my armor. Put on my breastplate. Put on my helmet. Take my shield. Take my spear." Well, David tried them on. Poor guy like to broke his leg. That's not in there. So you can do a Google search on it. It's not really in there. But if it should be. He almost broke his leg trying to walk in the armor. He quickly took the armor off. And he said, "I can't use this because I haven't proved it. I haven't tested it. This is not something that's passed a test." He said, "What I've got in my hand is a slingshot, and I've used it many times. I've fought with bears and lions. I've killed prey with it many times. I've used it, and it has never failed me." So he said, "Let me have my slingshot." And he went down by the riverbank, by the creek side. I was there, and I picked up the same, out of the same creek bed. I'm sure it was probably a different set of rocks, but I picked up 5 stones just like David, and I brought them back with me. And I'm about to unpack them. Hallelujah. I'm about to unpack them. I've got a mustard seed and I'm ready to use it. How about you? I've got rocks in my arsenal that I've proven over and over again. David said, "I can't use that stuff, but you give me these rocks. You give me this slingshot." And he went out and he took a swing like this as the giant came to him. The giant looked out and said, "You come to me with a slingshot and a stone?" David said, "Well, you're coming to me with a sword and a shield, but I'm coming to you in the mighty name of my Lord and my Savior, my King of Kings. My stones have been proven. It's the Rock of Ages, my friend. It's the stone, the rock that followed them through the wilderness. The stone, that rock was Jesus."
Amen.
Prove.
Hallelujah.
Use what's proven. Satan doesn't care about your philosophy.
That's right.
Come on. He doesn't care how you view politics. In fact, I don't think he cares which political party you belong to. Hello? He doesn't care if you Brexit or not. Brexit, excuse me. Thank you. It sounds too much like breakfast, so I do. He doesn't care if you're registered as a libertarian. It's not his ball game. He don't care. He's not afraid of that. He's not afraid of you because you can lift 400 pounds.
Amen.
How many in here can lift 400 pounds? Yes, sir. Understand. I used to leg press over 500 pounds. Those days are gone. Oh, for the wrestling days to come back. Well, they're still here. We just changed. We're wrestling. He don't care about that. What did Jesus use? Something that was proven. He said, "It is written." David said, "I come to you in the name of the mighty God that I serve. This day he's going to give you into my hands."
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. God's going to feed your carcass to the birds. It's time we stood up and started using things that are proven.
Amen.
Stop trying to philosophize with the devil. Stop trying to convince. Now, how many has talked to the devil this last week? Probably not any of us. Some of us think that we're so spiritual that, yes, Satan has vacated his spot and come down to just attack us personally. Probably not happening. But he's got a lot of imps.
Yes,
and demons.
Come on.
He's got a lot of workers in his army.
Yes,
that will come to you. He'll send a worker to you that will want to challenge your faith. Amen. Stop trying to challenge Satan in your own strength.
Yes.
Start using God.
Yes.
Using God's armor. Start fighting your battles. Use something that's proven. Hallelujah. You don't even care how many degrees you got. Amen. You can have so many degrees on your wall, they call you Brother Thermometer. None of that matters. What matters is what's proven, what's tested. The eagle always tests before it trusts. See, I can trust my Lord.
Amen.
Because he's never failed me.
Thank you, Jesus.
There's not one person in here that can make the statement, "Lord, you fail me." There's not one person in here that can say, "Lord, you let me down." You could say it, but it wouldn't be true. There's times when you messed up and you got out of what he was doing, and hey, that's not God's fault. I often do say, "Lord, you've never failed me, but you've come close a couple of times."
Yeah. Come on.
Huh?
Yeah.
I got to preach to this side. This side just went out. So I want you guys to say amen. If I preach to this side, I got to do this. He's never failed me, but he's come close a couple of times. But he's never failed me. He's always provided. He's always been there when I needed him. He's never late. Hallelujah. He's never late. He's the slowest person to always be on time. He's never late. He always is there. He always makes a way where there seems to be no way. He specializes in things that are thought impossible. I might have a river I think is uncrossable. I might have a mountain I can't tunnel through. But God specializes in things that are thought impossible. He will do what no other power can do.
Amen. Hallelujah.
Use what's tested. He's proven himself.
Hallelujah.
I'm going to do one more. An eagle loves to live in high places. We talked about flying high. But when an eagle is ready to lay their eggs, the female and the male, by the way, just so you know, male and females mate for life. Hello? This were a Baptist church, I'd be preaching that point. We Pentecostals got away from that. Some people change partners. I'm beginning to lose both sides now. I'm going to quit right there. Steve, take a lesson. It's never too late. But they do, they mate for life. That's a good point for us to realize. But when they get ready to lay their eggs, the female and the male will identify a place very high on a cliff where no predators can reach. The very definition of victory is overcoming an enemy.
Amen.
God wants us to have victory. It's the achievement or mastery or success in a struggle or endeavor against odds or difficulties. Our trials are for only a season. All the things that we go through are for a season. God's aim is for you to have victory. He wants you to have victory. They build their nests so predators can't get to them. We need to build our nest with victory in mind. Get away from the things that will rob you of your victory. Stay away from the things that will destroy your life. Get up and above those things when you're ready to nest in the Lord. Let Him be the one that hides you in the cleft of the rock. That's where we need to be, hidden in the cleft of that rock, away from the predators, away from things that will destroy us.
Amen.
It's only for a season. 1 Peter 1 and 6 says that the glory might result. Paul had the same thought in mind when he wrote 2 Corinthians 4 and 17. He said, these little troubles, I'm reading from the Phillips, from these little troubles, which really are just transitive in a state, are winning for us a permanent, glorious, and solid reward of all out of all the proportion to our pain. These are little things compared to the great things God is going to reveal to us, reveal for us. We got some awesome victories ahead of us. Start living in victory. Start claiming victory. Stop living in defeat. Stop wallowing in mud. Get up out of those places and get into the cleft of the rock, which is Christ, and start living in victory.
Amen.
God wants you to be victorious.
Hallelujah.
Do you understand something? God doesn't get any glory, and I'm wrapping it up. God doesn't get any glory out of your defeat.
Amen.
Now let me explain something. Does that mean you're going to win every fight? No. You're going to win the war.
Amen.
Sometimes we have to live to fight another day. Amen. Choose your battles wisely, by the way. Amen. God wants you to be victorious. The Bible says that greater is He that's in us than he that's in this world.
Amen. Hallelujah.
How many have Christ in you?
Amen.
Greater is He that's in you than he that's in the world. Those things that are in the world that are meant for your destruction, greater is He that's in you than that thing that's meant for your destruction. God wants you to be victorious. He wants you to have victory. He wants you to live above that situation. He wants you to get out of there. I'm closing. Thank you. Thank God for our LOLs. How many visitors are here this morning? How many do not know what we refer to as LOL around here? That's our little old ladies. Thank God for our LOLs. That's my aiming corner. But I was watching something. How many have Netflix? that how you say it?
Yeah.
I was watching something called Chasing Monsters the other day. You ever see that? Or is it Catching Monsters? Chasing, I don't know. Something about monsters. It's fishing anyway. You want to know what it's about. And I saw this guy go into Brazil to catch some great big fish about the size of that altar. To clip off a little part of his fin. This moron I can't see what I'm saying, so don't worry. Sometimes I get my tongue tangled around my eye teeth and I can't say a thing. He's marching through the jungles of Brazil with shorts on. And I'm thinking in my head, I'd always heard blondes were, no, wait a minute. Marching through this jungle with short pants on, I know what's in those jungles. This is the Amazon. This is Brazil. There's things there you don't even know about that will kill you. Their spit will kill you. The dust off their tails will kill you. They got spiders that will bite you and paralyze you, and you won't even know it. He's going to an area that in this little pond that he has to ride a boat up to the edge of the river, get out, drag another boat, smaller, across this land, get in, cross this one, and get in it. And he's back there, and it is full of caiman. How many know what caiman is? Might look a little bit like my boot. And it's full of python. Excuse me, I take that back. It's full. That's it, like a chubby. It's full of anacondas. He's showing pictures of these python, of these anacondas swimming. He's showing these caiman. And all of a sudden you hear a splash. That was just a caiman getting something out of me. So he throws his bait out. And he hooks. I don't know how they do that. I've tried that 1,000 times and can never hook. And all of a sudden it hooks and it starts dragging him into this water. And I'm looking out there and he's got that reel held as high as he can. Water up to his neck. I'm serious. The first thing I would have done. And I would have written those guys back at the lab, I couldn't get your fin. Why do we jump in with the piranhas? Why do we jump in with the anacondas? Why do we put ourselves in that situation? See, we need to get out of it. Get up above there. There was a high enough spot. Well, actually, the helicopter would have been the higher spot for me. But there was plenty of high ground for this guy to go. You see, there's high ground we can live in. You don't have to live down with the piranhas. You don't have to get into situations that will destroy you. See, an eagle understands something. They live above those things. Habakkuk tells us, the Lord God is my strength. And he will make my feet like hinds' feet. And he will make me to walk upon high places.
Hallelujah.
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 Get out of that damp, dirty basement of life and get into some high places that God can give you the victory in. He wants you to be victorious this morning. Would you stand to your feet? Hallelujah. Let me challenge you in the only way that this pastor knows how to challenge you. Stop playing in the devil's playground. He will devour you. Hallelujah. Glory. We're moving on up. We're moving on up.
Thank you, Lord.
Hallelujah. Would you bow your heads with us all over the building? I just want to ask you right where you're seated, if you're here this morning, you've been struggling. Maybe you got into something that you didn't test before you trusted. Maybe you're in some low places and you need God to lift you out this morning. It's not an embarrassment or a sin to have gotten yourself there. God wants to help lift you out. He sends people like your brothers and sisters to help you do that. If you say this morning, Pastor, would you just simply pray with me? I want to get out of those low places. I want to find some places of victory. God bless you. Hallelujah. I want to find victory in my life. Hallelujah. I want it to be said of me, there's a man of victory. There's a woman of victory. Hallelujah. Now I'm going to pray with you right where you're at for all those that raised your hands. Father, I thank you for every hand that was raised this morning. God, you are the one that gives us victory. You're the one that has been proven and proven time and time again, God, to be our tool of victory, our weapon of victory. Father, we thank you for it today. Father, make those that are here victorious. Help them to rise above those things that have tried to drown them, that have tried to destroy them. Help them to rise above it. Help them to live above it, to make their nest above it. Father, because it's been tested in this truth. In Jesus' name. Now with the rest of you, just lift your hands all over the building. In fact, could you sing this song, brother? I don't know if you have it up or not. Thank you.
Lord, you are my shield, my strength, my portion, you deliver my shelter.
God did.